I am now going to bring up our next speaker. I'm absolutely thrilled that he's been able to join us. I've been lucky enough to know Mike since we bonded over a bottle of sour cherry beer at lunch in Washington, D.C. a decade ago. He's shaped technology policy at the highest levels of government, and he brings an incredible balance of wisdom and exuberance to his thoughts on the future of technology. Today, Mike is a senior technology fellow for Technology and International Affairs Program at Carnegie Endowment for International Peace and a member of our advisory board. Prior to that, Mike has spent a lot of time working at the White House as Senator Gore's science advisor and in the White House doing science advice under the Clinton administration. And he wanted to make this session interactive. So it's going to be a bit of an experiment, but we tend to do that in the afternoons. As you can probably tell, we've got a little surprise planned for every afternoon break. So I'm going to be driving the slides and running some polls for him. For this to work, I need you to open up your mobile phone or another tab because we're going to make this interactive. So I'm going to bring up the screen that has our QR code on it. And Mike, if you want to join me on screen. Now, the screen you see here has a QR code or a URL. And so what I want you to do is pull out your phone, point the camera at the QR code, or go to menti.com, M-E-N-T-I.com, and enter in the code you see here, 1271186. And because there's a small delay, there's usually about a 10 to 12 second delay. While you're doing that, I want to make sure everybody gets in and is able to do that. How you doing, Mike?
Pretty good.
You ready to run this experiment?
Yes, I am.
All right. So we should have people looking at that right now, and you should see a thing saying it's time to go. And there's a little heart. So when we see you in there, click the little heart. I can see a few of those going up. I got 10 people in there right now. And we'll start to see people as they arrive on their phone or in their web browser. And even if you don't want to join in, I'm sure this is going to be fun to see what the results are. But basically, go and log in on menti.com with that code or scan the QR code. Hit those little hearts, and we will start to see people joining us. And just to warm us up, I want to know and tell the truth here. How did you dance with Gurdeep? Did you stand up and do it the way he said? Did you just watch enthusiastically from the sidelines? Did you do the whole upper body Bhangra? Or were you just too busy smiling at that incredible national treasure from the Yukon? And it looks like a lot of people actually stood up and did it, which is fantastic. Look at those numbers. And some people watched enthusiastically. I have to confess, I was watching enthusiastically. So what we see here is basically that a lot of people are actually doing this stuff, which is great. And what we know more importantly, Mike, is that they know how to vote in our polls. So I'm going to drive your slides. Hopefully I'll guess where you are, but if I go too fast, just say next slide or back up, like the old days, since you're joining us remotely from Washington, D.C. Is that right?
That's correct.
Awesome. And now we've definitely trained people. We got 62 responses here, so we should be able to get some interesting feedback for this session. And take it away, and I will try my best to follow along with you.
Alistair, thank you very much for the invitation to be here, and thanks for running my slides. I'm going to talk a lot about words today. But first, I want to introduce a word that I've used a lot, and that is balter. I'm not a very good dancer, but I know how to balter. This is a 400-year-old word that means to dance with little grace but great enthusiasm. And that's what I've been doing for the last 15 minutes while watching watching Gurdeep. I think it was W.C. Fields that said, never go on stage with cute animals or children. He didn't know about Gurdeep. I don't know that I'll forgive you, Alistair, for putting me on after his show, but hopefully got people going, got people excited. And for me, it's a great indication of why this is a very special conference. I was glad to be part of it last year when it was virtual for the first time. And it reminds me of the conferences, the tech conferences I went to almost 30 years ago. That's how long I've been a professional tech conference attendee. And that's how long I've been trying to understand technology. And one thing I've learned over those years is it's easy to talk about technology, it's hard to really communicate about technology. So what I'm going to do today is talk about words that are going to kill the internet and 10 words that could save it. The most important slide is right here. There are lots of Mike Nelsons in the world. So please write down my Twitter handle. It's just Mike Nelson. I was the first Mike Nelson to get on Twitter. Back when I was the Obama representative in the first ever presidential Twitter debate. That was in 2008, and we haven't had one since, but it was a three-day affair. Anyway, next slide is my background and why it is that I'm into words. I've been working on technology at the Clinton White House, as Alistair said. I spent 10 years at IBM working with governments around the world, trying to clarify for them what the internet was and how it was evolving. Spent 3.5 years teaching at Georgetown, and then moved on to Microsoft. Most recently, I was with Cloudflare. And then in the last year and a half, I joined the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace, which has been around for 111 years, and we're still trying to figure out how to make peace. But part of my work is trying to come up with good metaphors and buzzwords that will explain what technology is, explain how it's changing, and give people mental models that they can use to really understand what's going on. The first thing I learned in Washington when I came here in 1988 is on the next slide. And that is that you have to have good bumper stickers and good slogans, and that's what I'm going to provide today. And like any good professor, I'm going to provide lots of assignments and reading. But the most important part is we're going to do a little bit of research. We're going to do these polls that Alistair just demonstrated, and we're going to try to understand how you think about the internet and how we can change the way other people think of the internet. So next slide. So there's a lot of different things that shape our vision of the future. We've seen movies like War Games. We have a lot of television shows. The first flip phone was demonstrated on Star Trek more than 35 years ago. Cartoons, marketing videos. But what really shapes the internet is on the next page. And this is the poll I'd like to do. So I'm in Washington. We talk about policy. Policy shapes the internet as well as the technology and the business people. So what is it that you think is shaping digital policy? Is it deep, thoughtful analysis? Is it phone calls and emails from voters and constituents? Is it high-priced corporate lobbyists? Or is it whatever's on the front page of the newspaper and on Twitter that day? So I'll give you about 30 seconds to vote. Unfortunately, you can't vote for more than one, but this is a way just to give us a sense of how policy is made in your jurisdiction. I would like to vote for two here, but again, you only get one vote. I want to thank Alistair for setting this all up. This is quite a powerful tool. I've used some of the other ones, but this is.
It's fun to watch the little crowds. I'm going to sit here and we're going to banter a little bit while the votes come in because right. The wonders of technology are not quite real time, but this does make me wonder why we aren't using more direct democracy technologies more often in politics. I know I've seen some representatives of the U.S. Congress like live streaming how they did against their goals, but I wish we did more stuff like this.
I'm quite amazed that phone calls from constituents don't seem to have any impact at all in most places.
All right, I think we have a pretty good tally, 65, 66.
I think so, that's good. And it looks like we have a very close tie. You might know we're having an election here in Virginia today and the polls are 48-49. So we're going to be watching the election returns here in Virginia very shortly. So can we take the summary here?
Between lobbyists and whatever's on Twitter.
Yep. It does look like it is a very, very close split between the news and the lobbyists. And this brings me to the next point.
Oh, wait, we have to ask you where they work first.
Ah, okay. Right. In order to understand why you answered the way you did, we're asking people to tell us where they worked.
And there's, of course, alarms going on in the background. So we thought it would be fun to segment this to see, based on where you work, how the votes came in. So we have some people who are working in the national or federal government, regional governments, academia, private sector, and other. And we kind of wanted to see where the breakdown was. But I think, Mike, you got to say you got a lot of federal and national government folks online.
Yeah.
We're curious to see whether or not your votes correlate with a particular belief in where influence comes from. Looks like everybody believes the same thing.
Well, it does look like the private sector that pays for the lobbyists has a faith in.
Yeah, they don't, there's the people who are in other private sector do not believe in deep, thoughtful analysis.
Okay.
You can read into that what we want. Let's go to the next slide then.
Okay, so this is the most important thing that I want to convey today, and that is that you always have to have a good bumper sticker. This is actually the first thing I learned when I came to Washington. My mentor sat me down and he told me two things. The first thing was, you never want your name on the front page of the Washington Post, because that's almost a bad, it's almost always a bad story. And then second, you had to have a good bumper sticker. And often this was because when you were talking to a journalist, you want to give them the headline. You want to give them the six or seven words that communicate what it is that you're really talking about, what it is the bottom line is. It's also very helpful to give senators and ministers and presidents and prime ministers that simple sentence that they can understand, absorb, and then repeat over and over again. And so today we're going to talk about these bumper stickers. And we're going to talk about bumper stickers that are getting in the way and bumper stickers that can help us build a better digital future. Three books that you might want to look at on how to get good bumper stickers. My favorite is written by a linguist. It's only 80 pages long. It'll take you about an hour, and it will teach you to get really powerful, emotional slogans, tweets, headlines that will convey what you really need to convey. It's called MicroStyle. Just go to microstyle.org. Another book by Frank Luntz is called Words That Work. He worked for Newt Gingrich almost 20 years ago and came up with some of the most famous lines in the contract with America that Newt Gingrich used to win control of the House of Representatives. And then there's a new book by Andrew Hu called A Theory of the Aphorism. And it's a study of how philosophers have used aphorisms and bumper stickers to convey very complicated, very big ideas in seven or eight words. Things like Descartes, I think, therefore I am. But anyway, good places to look for those simple ways to work, to convey ideas. So next up, I wanted to just explore why bumper stickers are so important. And the main reason is because emotions trump analysis. And you have to convey in your bumper sticker some important emotional punch, something that gets people excited, just like the dancing did. So let me give you the 10 things that I think are the hot button issues in cyber policy. These are the things that end up in the headlines. These are the things that congressmen and senators rave about. Obviously, at the top of the list is privacy, but right behind that is piracy and fear of copyrighted content being stolen, pornography and hate speech, sort of unwanted illegal speech, protection of the internet and the data that's on it, pricing, everybody wants a fair price, policing, illegal activity online. And again, this is very emotional when we get into some of the very sad stories about cyber fraud, cyber crime. Psychology. When I first made this list 15 years ago, everybody scratched their head and wondered what I was talking about. Now we're all talking about the adverse impacts of too much screen time, violent video games, and also disinformation, particularly on the elderly or on the young. Procurement is also an emotional issue. We have Buy America provisions, payment, and the idea that we'll have digital cash and anonymous cash, and then protectionism. How are countries trying to keep out foreign applications and foreign services? So anyway, 10 very important triggers, things that shape our policy, often in bad directions, because again, we're driven by emotion, not analysis. So next slide. So this is a slide meant to be a poll. So just pick one or two of these that you think are the most emotional or powerful drivers of cyber policy, the things that get politicians and policymakers excited, the things that get journalists excited. Maybe they're things that get you excited. Maybe so people don't want to say.
I'm trying to figure out which one, because there's a lot to choose from here.
Yep. Or maybe people are so concerned about privacy, they don't want to reveal it.
You first came up with this 10 years ago?
15.
15 years ago. Wow.
Yeah.
Some of these things, like, I mean, you know, payments was back then. I'm old enough to remember don't put your address on the internet. And now it's like, I'm going to tweet when I leave home. So some of these that was way ahead of its time. If you were talking about payments back then.
Well, we were talking about digital cash. That was DigiCash was the first version, but it made people very emotional back then. I mean, governments were afraid that they would lose control.
It does seem to me that technology goes through this arc of, you know, first it's this utopian thing that may have come out of the military or academia or whatever, but we think it's going to be wonderful, like the whole Earth electronic link and the Clue Train manifesto and stuff. And then it becomes commercialized with ads, and then it becomes criminalized. People figure out how to exploit it. And then it becomes sort of nationalized or turned into a utility. And it really feels like these things go through that cycle over and over again. So as a researcher, I would look at these results and say people clicked on the first result because that they tend to do that and didn't scroll down. But that does look like privacy has a pretty big lead here, Mike.
Out of 7, I guess I should have randomized it. But anyway, very, very useful, very interesting.
Over half the people, 37 out of 71, chose privacy.
Yep. Okay, next. So I'm now going to run through a bunch of broken mental models, things that are causing bad policy to be promulgated, and propose some things that we can do to think about it differently. The first one is incredibly important, and that is the idea of cyberspace. This is, first of all, a word that's been defined in about three different ways, fundamentally incompatible ways. The term was first really popularized by William Gibson, who described cyberspace as a consensual hallucination experienced daily by billions of legitimate operators in every nation. So for him, cyberspace was a place in your head. It was a feeling you had when you were connecting to other people. UNESCO, which focuses on culture, describes it as a worldwide virtual space different from real space, a place full of community and ideas. Now, that's completely different from the way the U.S. Defense Department describes it. They describe it as a real place, a global domain within the information experience consisting of the interdependent networks of the IT infrastructure and its resident data, including the internet, telecommunications networks, computer systems, and embedded processors and controllers. So for them, it's a place. And they talk about it as a place. Cyberspace is the new battlefield. Completely wrong. That's not where the data is. The data is scattered everywhere and it's moving constantly. But when you say cyber space, you get people thinking about borders and battlefields and being able to control the machines. Completely wrong. Completely the wrong place to start. So next slide. Instead, we should be talking about the data sphere and focusing on the data itself and talking about data moving as if it were air through the atmosphere. Data being global, like the atmosphere, flowing freely. Big change. And this would enable us to really think anew about how to use cloud computing, edge computing, the Internet of Things, use the low Earth orbiting satellites that Elon Musk is putting up there, and to tap into this data sphere so that we can find new ways to do online collaboration, new ways to do machine learning. This is the cloud of things. And again, a very important new way of thinking about what we're doing. Next slide. We all know how fast this is happening. And again, doubling every 2 years. And if we let it happen, doubling even faster than that, because the data will be flowing freely, and we'll be combining it in new ways. Next slide. The other thing that I think we need to talk about is the fact that it's more than just big data. It's BIFMUD. Obviously, there's lots of data, but it's also fat data. Each person has lots of different fields in their data set, and it's fast, and it's moving, and it's changing fast, and it's messy. And most of all, it's distributed. That's what's really different about this new world we're building. It's not just about big data. We've had that for 30 years. It's about the data sphere, distributed, fast moving, fast changing data. Next slide. The next model we have to fix is that the internet is a network. This leaves policymakers to take all the old rules about networks, telephones and television, and try to apply them. They could wiretap the telephone. They could censor the television. They want to do the same thing with the internet. Wrong. Next slide. The right way to think about this is the internet is a computer. It's a global computer. It's got data. It's got computational capability, it's got storage, and we don't allow people to censor what's on our computer in our home. We don't allow people to censor and to wiretap and to apply surveillance techniques to our computer without lots of warrants, without clear judicial authorization. Very different world than the old world of networks. Next slide. So in this new world, we have the opportunity to make the network the computer. This is a slide from Sandy Pentland, who's one of my heroes. He's a professor at MIT, and he's promoting the idea of data unions. And the idea here is that we don't suck all the data into a few companies like Facebook and Amazon and Google and create a giant data ocean. That's the old model. That's where you suck up all the data and then you process that data. What instead we do is we encourage the development of these data unions, third parties that take care of data about me, store it for me, and allow that data to be used in all sorts of interesting ways with my permission, usually anonymously. So this is an idea that's fundamental. The data sits there in the data unions, tens of thousands of them, hospitals, grocery stores, social media platforms. But the key difference is we now move the algorithm to the data. So we can tap these different data sets, asking specific questions that usually will not involve personal private data, but will give us insights into our community, into diseases, into the environment, into health and into safety issues. It's a fundamentally different way of thinking. Sandy's just published a new book called Building the New Economy, and it develops this idea in a lot more depth than I can do today. Next slide. So this is the book. As I said, it's called Building the New Economy, and it's available online for free. Next slide. Another dangerous, dangerous idea is that data is the new oil, that somehow it's consumable and excludable, that either I have the data or you have the data. Wrong. Next slide. Data is the new air. This is a much cleaner way of thinking about it. All of us can breathe the same air. We can filter the air. Plants can use one part of the air, or the carbon dioxide. We can use the oxygen. There's a lot of different ways to use air and lots of different ways to combine it. And as I said, in the data sphere, data moves like air across borders. Next slide. We already talked about this a bit. If you focus on the Internet of Things, you're focusing just on moving the bits. The Cloud of Things focuses on where the bits are and how we use the computing power embedded in the cloud to use those bits and to get the bits from the things. Th- this is, again, it's a subtle thing, but we have to move that direction. Another problem is the idea of your data. How in the world can you decide what is your data? Next slide. The key is to talk about data about us and to find ways to share that part of the data that doesn't divulge information we don't want divulged. So again, it's about making the world work in a ways that data flows and my privacy is protected. So next slide. This is a scenario that we developed for the Internet Governance Forum USA, and it's about how you can do this. Today, we're off in the bottom right corner. We don't have a lot of privacy. We have quite a bit of innovation because people are trying lots of things and haven't had to worry too much about privacy. We've avoided data chaos where there's no standards and no norms. But what we can do is move up into the top right corner where we have these data unions that are designed to protect my privacy and share data and foster innovation. If we don't do this, we're going to end up in the top left. We're going to end up in a world where countries and companies are hoarding the data. They're making boundaries across which they don't want data to flow. And again, this is partly because of this idea of cyberspace. It's also partly a result of countries thinking that data is the new oil, and the more data they hoard, the more money they'll make. Vince Cerf said it best. Information is power, but information sharing is far more powerful. Next slide. So we have a lot of problems to face. We've talked about some of these already. We have to figure out how to use encryption to make these data unions work. Obviously, we need broadband. We have to avoid SplinterNet and the idea of data localization. We do need digital identity. This is an issue I'm sure you're talking about in other sessions. We're doing a lot of work on that, looking at what's gone on in places from Estonia to India to Malaysia. Next slide. So the last mental model I wanted to address is the issue of intellectual property. And this is getting in the way of a lot of the regulation around the internet. It's causing the Europeans to want to put filters on everything that gets uploaded to the internet. The whole idea that bits are the same as real estate or a car, when you can make a near infinite number of copies of bits, it makes no sense at all. So next slide. Instead, we need to think about a data substrate where I can share content in bits in return for payments, where I don't need to lock up everything because there's easy ways to reward people who create data sets, reward people who share their data. It's a very different mindset. And again, it gets away from the idea that data is to be hoarded. If we don't do this, if we don't change this mindset, we're not going to move from the information society we have today to the data society where we can tap into all the data being generated by sensors, as well as all the data and information being produced by each of us. Instead, we're going to end up with a content society. It's not going to be everybody sharing with everybody. It's going to be a handful of content producers controlling most of the content that we watch, all locked down by these copyright filters. Very different world. So let me ask you, which of these metaphors and buzzwords and bumper stickers worry you the most? And you can just move your slider back and forth on this. For cyberspace, big data, network, new oil, your data, and intellectual property. And you can rank them all dangerous. You can disagree with me entirely and say, none of them bother me. And if you want, please tweet and tell me what you think is the most dangerous bumper sticker if you have a better idea.
Are you voting? Is that cheating? I didn't vote.
I was going to vote.
I think I've said all of these words today. So yeah, that's and it's interesting to see what the scores are like in these. By dangerous, do you mean dangerous to society? Dangerous.
Dangerous because they result in bad business decisions. They result in bad policy. And in some cases, I think they result in a lot of anxiety by people who are worried about big data or worried about, this is interesting. So new oil.
When you said, emotion trumps rational analysis, something like that. Like just having the word Trump in there got people to. But I do think that if you go back and look at the lessons from like neurolinguistic programming and what things cause, you know, the system one kind of immediate response, it really is true that getting people to take a step back and reconsider things means messing with their frames, with how things are framed. I loved the talk this morning where Carolyn Polko said, how about we terraform Earth? Because terraforming sounds like something that, you know, Bezos and Musk can totally get behind. That sounds amazing. I've played video games. I mean, we all know Elon Musk is just playing Civilization, right? He's doing the talent tree thing. I'm waiting to buy a vertical farming company, but he's got boring and he's got solar and he's got engines and he's got rockets. But if you frame it as terraforming Earth, it changes the perspective and makes it cool. And it seems to me like so much of this is just framing policy in a way that produces fair results.
Yeah. Well, I think the most important thing we do is that we equate technology with joy. I've been a professional meeting attender and a speaker for 30 years. And 30 years ago, there was so much joy and curiosity and excitement and a sense that there weren't that many boundaries. I mean, today you go to a conference and people tend to assume there's just so many constraints. I don't hear that at your conference, which is why I'm so happy to be part of this. Yeah, there's much more of a sense of experimentation and let's just give it a try. That's where we need to be with this.
So I think you got some answers here.
Okay. It looks like we've got a near tie, although new oil seems to be slightly ahead of the other two, your data and intellectual property. I think all three of those cause a huge amount of confusion. Unfortunately, the phrase new oil was on the cover of The Economist. So it's gotten lots of coverage. So can we go to the next page? The one on anecdotes, on antidotes?
Yeah.
And anecdotes. So these are ideas that I've proposed as things that might change the conversation. I don't know that I explained data union well enough. I'm hoping I did.
Let me see if I can take a stab at it. You're talking about federation of data, right?
So, I'm talking about, yeah, that's where you get to.
Right.
But the key thing is the balance of power and responsibility. So if I contract with a data union, it's like when I contract with a credit union or a bank. I give the bank my money. It knows where my money is. It takes care of it. It sends my money to the people I want my money to go to. And there's an audit capability. Same thing for data. In a data union, I will have a contract with the people who have data about me, and they will be able to tell me when and where they're sharing my data. And they can generate a lot of revenue off this because there are some great things that machine learning will do with totally anonymized data, as long as it's high quality and there's enough of it from a diverse community of people. And that's, I think the first place we're seeing this already is in research. The researchers are starting to build data unions and repositories. They're allowing people to slice and dice the data in different ways. And one data base or one data union or data repository might lead to 1,000 different papers in 15 different disciplines. Very exciting opportunity.
Your data. Where people say, you know, that's my data. Don't take my data.
It's well, data. That's the problem. You know, you take a picture of me. You take a picture of the two of us, do a selfie. Is that your data? Is it my data because my picture's in there? Is it Facebook's data because you posted on Facebook?
Right. As opposed to saying it's a picture of us and therefore the people portrayed might have certain rights or obligations as a result of that. But the photographer has rights and so does the conveyance and the format and so on.
I think the most interesting thing here is the complete lack of agreement on BIFMUD.
Well, you know, I think, you know, big data, messy data and all that stuff. I do like the histograms here so you can see which ones have some amount of polarization, like data substrate. You know, you can see there's a few proponents of the data sphere sort of tugging it upwards there. But looking at the shape of these things, it does look like the data union one has, you know, widespread 2, 3, 4 support kind of on the reading here.
Well, that was my hidden agenda here, was to get people to read more about data unions, data cooperatives, data trusts. We have to get a common frame first, but unfortunately, the bumper stickers don't agree on what buzzword to use.
That is always the challenge with bumper stickers. Okay, should we move on?
Yes, please. We're almost done. So we have this fundamental choice. How can we convince people that we're building a global computer? And how can we develop policies that treat it that way? The other useful analogy I have when people say, well, you know, we censor the TV. Why don't we censor the internet? I like to point out the fact that the internet is so much more pervasive, and most of the things that get put on the internet are shared with just a handful of people. So it's not like television. Indeed, the internet's much more like paper, and we don't hold the manufacturers of paper responsible for what gets printed on the giant prints, giant rolls of newsprint that they produce. Next slide. So some other things to think about is trust, because at the end of the day, that's what we're trying to achieve. I won't read all of this, but we've all heard about Orwell's 1984. That's a world in which governments know everything and we don't know what they know. David Brin has written The Transparent Society, which is just the opposite. We know what the government knows. And we also know much about what's going on around us. We have situational awareness.
I should point out, Mike, I'm going to take a quick plug here. We've been doing these executive book clubs. And thanks to you, met David Brin, and we're literally doing an executive book club on December 3rd with David on the Transparent Society and his new book on how Hollywood is shaping possible tomorrows. Such a fascinating person. So yeah, we're having a discussion about that where everybody, the question is not whether we should be on camera, but who's on the other side of it.
Yep. Well, his idea is two-way transparency. I call it mutually assured disclosure. I will share information with you, but you're going to tell me exactly what you're doing with it. Right. And that's, again, where the data union comes into play. Another thing I'd plug is the Carnegie Encryption Working Group, which is written about how do we get encryption deployed in a way that protects us and also allows law enforcement to collect data, not the encrypted data, but other data that could be useful in law enforcement activities. So next slide. So just to concluding, never forget that we're still in early days. When I first started doing this, I would say the internet revolution was less than 1% complete. I'd say it's probably about 25% complete. But the digital transformation that it's enabling and all the societal changes that will come with it, that's probably 10, maybe 15% of the way through. And remember, it took 100 years before we saw all the impacts of the printing press. The printing press enabled mass literacy. It enabled Martin Luther to start the Reformation because they could print his diatribes and share them with hundreds of thousands, even millions of people. That led to the 30 Years' War, which wasn't a very nice outcome. But there's been a lot of impact of the internet already. The cloud is multiplying that impact, and we're going to see even more. My final bumper sticker is the one that I always share, and that is we have to empower users. We have to accept the change. We have to see beyond the infrastructure. We have to focus on the ideas and the data, and we have to prototype, prototype, prototype. I'm happy to have feedback on Twitter, @MikeNelson. There's a lot of unanswered questions here, but if we can at least get talking about it the right way and use some new words and new ideas, I think Washington and Brussels and Ottawa and Tokyo and Beijing and New Delhi, they can figure it out too and enable the new opportunities that we're talking about at this conference. So thank you very much, Alistair. This was a quick tour through a rather confusing landscape, but I hope it stimulated some ideas. And I know I got some interesting answers from some of the survey results.